Well, tonight, I was kind of thinking about what we needed to talk about, because in May, we're talking about having a heart for the house and what having a heart for the house really means. And when we say heart for the house, we mean God's house, this house, the church that we're all a part of, the church that we're connected to. And so leading into that, I wanted to talk about something that's near and dear to this house, something that everything revolves around. And we talk about all the time being a movement, right? The church is a movement, not a monument. There you go. Thank you. It's not a monument. A monument stays exactly where it started at from the beginning. A movement is always moving forward, always doing things, doing new things, doing more powerful things, and growing as it moves. And that's what the church is designed to be. And so if we're going to be a movement, you need to understand one thing, that every movement in the world that's ever impacted the world, whether good or bad, rises and falls on leadership. It rises and falls on leadership. And you may hear that word and you're like, I'm going to tune him out. I don't have anything else to listen to right now because I'm not a leader. Well, that's false, because we are all a leader in some aspect. We are all leaders in our own spheres of influence. You have parents, you're leaders to your kids. You're leaders in your homes. You own a business, you're a leader at your job. If you're a manager, you're a leader there. You lead other employees. You lead your coworkers. If you're a coach, obviously, you're leading those athletes on your team. Or if you're an athlete, you could be a leader on your team to your other teammates. Everyone is a leader in some aspect, whether you believe it or not. And so understanding that we're a part of a movement and that every movement rises and falls on leadership. I mean, you can think about the civil rights movement. You have Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. He was all about peace, right? Then you have Malcolm X. He was all about by any means necessary. You know, I did my senior thesis in college on the Black Panther Party, so I know all about that stuff. I love the civil rights movement. Anyway, that's a sidebar. So anyway, you have good leadership and you can have bad leadership. You know, you have Adolf Hitler and Nazi Germany created a movement, a not-so-great movement, but it was a movement nonetheless. And so what you're going to see is, if we're going to be a movement in the church, and if we're going to do anything worth anything here on this earth while we're here, you need to understand first and foremost that you are a leader in the church. You do have something to offer. And people will follow you, and people do follow you. But there's some things that you need to remember as we go and build this movement, because you're a part of it just as much as I am. I just get to hold a microphone and talk. You're down in there. We all get to be a part of it. So right, I want to talk tonight as if this is one big New Hope staff meeting. All right, I felt like this is what we needed to talk about. And I wanted to talk about one of our core values. It's one of four core values. Intentional leadership. That's what I wanted to talk about. And I want to help you understand that you need to take the lead. You need to take the lead. Say, take the lead. Take the lead. I'm not talking about dancing. I'm talking about leadership. All right? So take the lead. Our four core values. Intentional leadership, unwavering commitment, genuine community, and uncommon giving. All those four things make up who we are at New Hope International, and it helps us accomplish our vision of leading people to Jesus no matter the cost. So why is it so important for us to know about leadership? Well, our vision, the second word in our vision is lead. To lead people to Jesus no matter the cost. And there's a reason we chose the word lead. We didn't choose win people to Jesus. We didn't choose show people Jesus. We didn't choose direct. We chose to lead people, because when you lead, that word automatically requires that you do something. It automatically requires that as you look ahead in your own relationship with Jesus, you have to look back and pull somebody with you. That's what that implies. Leadership makes you do something. Leadership requires something from you. And it requires it through our vision at a no matter the cost attitude. And if we're going to have a no matter the cost attitude, we need to take hold of this word lead and understand that you are a leader and people do and can be influenced by you, and you need to realize that, because you're either hurting people or helping people, and you don't even realize it because you don't think you're a leader. But you are. Every person is a leader in this room. So if we're going to say we're going to lead people to Jesus, then we better know a thing or two about leadership, no matter if you're a leader in a ministry here or you're not. It doesn't matter. You need to understand what leadership is all about. And Jesus, obviously, is the greatest leader ever. He's the greatest leader. And so in Matthew chapter 15, there's a story that happens, all right? And I was reading through this, and this is a great story about leadership and a great example. And let me give you a little context. Jesus and his disciples, Jesus and the boys, they're hanging out. They're about to eat. And they just dive right in. They start eating. And the Pharisees off to the side, they speak up. And they're like, hey, why don't your disciples wash their hands before they eat, as tradition says? They weren't upset because, like your mom was when you were a kid and you came in from playing and you started eating and didn't wash your hands. It wasn't like that, all right? It was a traditional thing and a sacred thing for people to wash their hands and to cleanse themselves before they went and ate. And so these Pharisees noticed that because they're all about rules. They're all about tradition. They're all about following the law. And so they asked Jesus, why didn't your disciples wash their hands? And Jesus gets a little upset. He gets a little irritated because religious people will just do that to you. They just upset you. They'll just irritate you with their stupid questions, right? It's okay. You can say yes. They're not here, I don't think, anyway. So, but they'll just ask these questions, and they will upset you like they upset Jesus. And Jesus got upset. He said something about somebody's mama. He brought daddy into it. He started calling them names. He called them a hypocrite. And then he was like, you guys always are talking about me, but you don't even know me. You guys, you talk about me a lot. My name is always coming out of your mouth, but you don't even know who I am. You ever say that to somebody? You don't even know me. And you put a quiver in your voice. You don't even know me. You don't know me. You have to fight back tears. You don't know me. That's what Jesus was saying. You don't even know me. You draw close to me with your lips, but your heart is far from me. And that's what he's saying to all these Pharisees who worry about washing their hands and keeping the tradition going. And then he says this to the crowd. He calls a crowd. He's so upset, he calls a crowd around. Hey, listen, come here. Listen to what these jabronis are saying over here. Okay, listen. He says, listen and understand. What goes into someone's mouth does not defile them. But what comes out of their mouth, that is what defiles them. Okay, you guys can say all the things you want, but it's what comes out of your mouth. It's what you say. It's an outward expression that determines your value. That it determines how influential you can really be. And he's not just talking about words here. He's talking about what you do, how you live, an outward expression. And it's not what goes in. It's what comes out that defiles a man. And the disciples come over, and they're like, hey, Jesus, you kind of ticked them off for saying that, man. You kind of ruffled a few feathers. The Pharisees didn't like that. They're kind of offended that you said that. And Jesus is like, yeah, I know. That's why I said it. I wanted them to hear it. I wanted them to know that they're being fake, that they're not being genuine, that their heart is far from me, but they think they're close to me because they're talking about me. They think talk is good enough. And then he says this. He says, every plant that my heavenly Father has not planted will be pulled up by the roots. Every person, if you're not rooted in God, if you're not rooted in his word, if you're not rooted in a relationship with Jesus, you'll be pulled up like a root from the root. And that's where leadership begins. That's where true leadership begins. It begins in the heart. It begins with your heart. It begins with the things that you think nobody else knows. It begins with the things that could eat at you. It's eroding your heart, but you don't even realize it. And it begins with the bitterness. It begins with the unforgiveness. It begins with the jealousy. It begins with the envy. It begins with all that. If it's not cleaned out and you don't allow God to come in and clean you and wash you, how are you ever going to influence somebody with any true value? How are you ever going to be a part of a movement with bitterness in your heart? How are you ever going to be a part of a movement if you're allowing what comes out of you to defile you? And that's what Jesus is saying here. But then he says this in verse 14, and I love this part. And we're not going to be really long tonight, so I hope you're excited about that. It may still be light outside by the time we leave. Verse 14, he says, leave them. Leave those flunkies. Leave those fakes. Leave those fake leaders who are leading. Leave those people. He says, leave them. They are blind guides. They're blind. They're blind to their own pride. They're blind to their own egos. They're blind. They're blinded by their position. They're blinded because they have status. They're blinded because they're somebody. That's blinding them. But yet they're guiding people. They're guide. He calls them guides. He said, where are they leading them to? How do they know where they're going? They're leading people and they don't even know where they're going themselves. It's dangerous to follow a leader where he don't even know where he's going himself. When a leader has no clear direction, you're following a blind person. You're following someone who has no clue. You're following someone who has no idea. They're oblivious to the fact of where they're going and don't even realize it. But yet they're leading other people. They're leading people who are blind themselves. And then Jesus says this, if the blind lead the blind, both will fall into a pit. If the blind lead the blind, it's one thing to be a blind leader, it's another thing to be a blind follower. Okay, you can be, I get the blind leader part because when you get a certain position of power and you get a certain amount of influence, you think, oh, I'm good, people are here to serve me, I'm good. And we try to get rank and get position based off how many people we can get to serve us. When that's the backwards way that Jesus even set it up. He said, if you want to be great, you need to be the servant of all. Even I didn't come to be served, I came to serve. That's what Jesus said. But when we get blinded by that, and then other people are blinded by it, catastrophe is happening because the blind leader I get, but it's the blind follower. It's the blind follower because we all follow somebody. We're all led by somebody. So how are you going to know what great leadership looks like if you don't even know where to look and how to look? How are you going to know what true leadership looks like if you don't even know what leadership is all about? How are you going to know what leadership if you're following the right leader? If you don't know anything about leadership. That's why leadership is so important, that we should study it, that we should gain as much knowledge as we can about leadership. Because how do we know the people we're following, the leaders we're following, myself included, I'm going to be held accountable one day for how I led this church. I'll be held accountable for that. That's what the Bible says. So I'm doing my best not to be blind. I'm doing my best to let God lead me. And I hope you would understand that to be a movement and to change the world and to turn the world upside down, that we all have to grasp this concept of what leadership really is. We have to take the lead. We have to take the lead in our homes. We have to take the lead in our schools. We got to take the lead in our relationships. We got to take the lead wherever we are because God's called us all to be leaders and to be influencers for his kingdom. But how are you going to influence someone if you don't even know what a good leader looks like? How will you know what kind of leader to be if you don't know what leadership looks like? This isn't a foreign concept. I mean, we deal with leadership in every aspect. I mean, at your job, that's the best example. Leadership is what makes a movement rise or fall. But yet, so many people know so little about it. And Jesus provides the perfect example of leadership. And if you're following a leader who doesn't know where he's going, then you're blindly following. And you don't even know if they're leading you towards a great movement or a bad movement. You don't even know if the movement that's being created is something that's actually going to have a positive impact in the world. Let me read you something. I'll give you an example. Let me read you something. I see blank stares, but let me just read you something. It's an excerpt, and you'll figure out who it's about as I keep reading, so just listen. There is a special trap for every holder of power, a leader, every holder of power, whether the director of a company, the head of the state, or the ruler of a dictatorship. His favor is so desirable to his subordinates that they will sue for it by every means possible. Servility becomes endemic among his entourage, who compete among themselves in their show of devotion. This, in turn, exercises a sway upon the ruler, leader, who becomes corrupted in his turn. The key to the quality of the man in power or the woman in power is how he reacts to this situation. I have observed a number of industrialists and military men who knew how to fend off this danger. Where power has been exercised over generations, a kind of hereditary incorruptibility grows up. Only a few individuals among those around Hitler, such as Fritz Tott, withstood the temptation to sycophancy. Hitler himself put up no visible resistance to the evolution of a court. Did you kind of understand? There's a lot of big words in there. I don't even understand some of them myself. Basically, when you become a person of influence, you gain influence with other people, right? You gain a certain amount of power. Let's just call it what it is. And when you're a leader, people want to gain an inroad with you. When you have a position of influence, they want to get close to the leader because, hey, I know the head man. I know the head woman. And this example is talking about Hitler, where every man around him was trying to vie for his attention, trying to let Hitler know that anything you say, yes, we're for it. Anything you want to do, Hitler, we're all yours. Anything, hey, I feel like I should disagree, but I want to gain so much inroad with this leader that I'm going to put my own morals to the side and let him influence me in a negative way. What would have happened in Nazi Germany if somebody had stood up in his inner circle and said, you know what, guys, this isn't right. This isn't quite right. This isn't what we should be doing. We have a golden opportunity here. We have an opportunity to change the world, but yet we're killing half of it. A movement, the kind of movement that can change the world. If we would gather together on this concept of leadership and understand that we are leading in some kind of way and that we can't be blind to it. We can't be blind to the pitfalls that come when we gain influence. We can't leverage our own influence to serve ourselves. Jesus obviously was the perfect example. And we're going to talk about that in May coming up when we talk about having a heart for the house. That when you get this position of power, when you gain influence, and you start to lead, and you're leading in your homes, don't leverage that influence for your own selfish gain. Don't leverage that influence and use it to do what you want. It's always about the betterment of the rest of the people. It's always about that. And this doesn't just apply in church world, all right? You may be a business person right now. You may be a teacher. You may be an educator. This applies because you have power. You have power. You have control in some aspect. But if you don't realize that and you don't even know where you're going, you're blindly walking and you're blindly leading people with you to a disaster. And you don't even realize it. And then in verse 15, the story continues. All right, the story continues. And Peter says, of course, Peter speaks up. Peter's always got the biggest mouth. He's always asking Jesus what he meant and getting embarrassed for it. God bless Peter. Peter said, explain the parable to us. And Jesus is like, are you still dull? That's what Jesus said to Peter. Are you kidding me? Do you not get this? Jesus asked them, don't you see that whatever enters the mouth goes into the stomach and then out of the body? But the things that come out of a person's mouth come from the heart, and these defile them. Again, he's going back to the heart. Do you understand how important the matters of your heart are? Do you understand how important the matters that you bury deep in your heart are if you let them sit there? You ever seen that show, Storage Wars? Yeah, people leave stuff in their own little storage unit and leave it there for somebody else to come and deal with their junk. Our heart is a storage unit. And when we don't clean it out and we don't allow God to clean it out, we're playing storage wars with people because we're taking our junk to the next person. Hey, do you want this? Do you want to deal with my bitterness? Hey, do you want this jealousy? Can you deal with it? Do you want to take it? No? All right, too high? All right. Do you want to deal with my impatience? Do you want to deal with my attitude? Do you want to deal with that? And we don't deal with the heart, and it ruins us, and it has the potential to ruin other people because we have influence. We all have a certain amount of influence. Being a great leader and knowing how to follow a great leader begins in the heart. Being a great leader, because I believe every person in this room can be a great leader. Every person in this room has the potential to be an impactful leader wherever you are, whatever sphere of influence you are in every single day. You have the potential to be a great leader. But it begins in the heart. And if you're going to follow a great leader, you got to know one when you see one. It takes one to know one, right? Remember that? So what's in your heart? What's in your heart? Are you constantly dealing with bitterness? Are you constantly dealing with jealousy, things that should have been dealt with long ago, but you just left it there and you let it linger and you didn't bother dealing with it because you just feel like you could dump it on somebody else and you take it and you carry it from relationship to relationship because nobody else wants to deal with it and your relationships are short-lived, friendships are short-lived because you refuse to deal with the matters of the heart? Are you someone who constantly talks about people? Are you building people up? Are you tearing them down with your words? The Bible says the power of life and death is in the tongue. You're either going to speak life or you're going to speak death. There's no gray area. You're either speaking wisdom, you're speaking knowledge, you're speaking truth, or you're speaking death. Are you someone like that? Eleanor Roosevelt has a great quote. I love this quote. Listen. Just see where you fall in this category, all right? Great minds discuss ideas. Average minds discuss events. Small minds discuss people. Do I need to read that again? Okay, I heard a profound yes from the crowd. Great minds discuss ideas. Average minds discuss events. Small minds discuss people. I'll just let you decide where you fall in that category, okay? But here at New Hope International, we're not about talking about people. We're not about talking about each other. We're not about that. We're not about drama. We're not about that. We're about a movement. We're about a movement. We're about ideas. We're about what's the next great idea, God, that you can give me that'll help lead someone to Jesus no matter the cost? God, what's the next great idea that you can give us that's going to change the world? God, what's the next great idea that you're going to give us that's going to help us reach our city even better? What idea can you give us to reach someone on the other side of the world? Because after all, we do have international in our church name, so we better be doing something throughout the world, right? God, give us an idea. But so many times churches are focused on people. They're talking about people, talking about each other. Can you believe what she did? I can't believe she showed up. I can't believe she's even here. Does she know no one even likes her when she comes around? Talking about people. Small minds discuss people. That blew me away when I read that. And I hope it did something for you. I hope it changes the way you talk. I hope it changes the way you talk. Because it holds you accountable to your vocabulary. It holds you accountable to what you're saying to people. And it can prevent you. Can prevent you from just defiling yourself. It can prevent you from messing yourself up, because it's not what goes in, it's what comes out. And if you're constantly tearing down other people, constantly frustrated about other people, and just irritated, and can't, and it's all about people, it's all about people, oh, I can't stand, you have a small mind. Great minds discuss ideas. Let me ask you a question. And this will identify something in you, hopefully. What is the consistent end result from your dealings with other people? I just think about the question. What is your consistent end result from your dealings with other people? Okay, so in your dealings with people, are people constantly frustrated with you? Are people constantly irritated with you? Are people constantly annoyed because there's just something about you that you're not seeing about yourself? Are you leaving conversations and arguing? Or are you leaving conversations in peace? Are you leaving conversations with joy and happiness? Or are you leaving them with negativity and tearing down other people? By answering that question, do people not like to see you coming their way? Oh, God, here he comes. I got to talk to this guy. Hey, here she comes, you know. Do people enjoy see you coming their way? I mean, only you can answer that question, because nobody's really going to tell you that, are they? Hey, man, I hate it when you walk my way, all right? Can't stand talking to you, to be honest with you. If we said that, we wouldn't have any friends. But what's the consistent end result between you and other people? Are you constantly in an argument mode? You got to dig deep. You got to look in your heart right now, because I can't answer that question. The person next to you can't. Well, they may be able to answer that question. But, you got to answer it for yourself. And Jesus knew long ago, hey, it's not what goes in, it's what comes out, because that's a matter of the heart. Hey, Matthew, you writing that down? Write that down, Matthew, because I got a feeling centuries from now, there's some people that are going to need to know that. There's some people that are going to need to know that I just said, it's not what goes in, it's what comes out, because that's what makes a tremendous leader, because you got to look deep down in your core. The core of who you are as a person. Because you have influence, whether you know it or not. And the decisions you're making, the choices you're making, is impacting your influence. The people you're putting yourself around that don't care about influence. They don't care about your leadership. They don't care about that. And their lifestyle may be negatively affecting you and your influence. I always say you need to take a friendventory, right? You got to take a friendventory and check who's around you. Are they people that are helping you grow as a leader? Are they people that are pushing you towards your purpose? Or are they people that are constantly the small-minded people that are always discussing people? I always want to talk about somebody with you. I always want to gossip. And our vision is to lead people to Jesus no matter the cost. It's to lead. That's the statement of a movement. I want you to understand that we're not here just to have another church service. We're not here just to do things the traditional way. All right? God's called us to the world. He's called us to reach people not only in Warner Robins. He's called us to reach people in Africa. He's called us to reach people in London. He's called us to reach people in California. He's called us to reach people in Atlanta. He's called us to reach people all over. But if we don't grasp the concept that you are a leader and you're a part of the movement, and you're a part, and you have a part to play in it, then we'll never fully be the movement that God wants us to be. And you got to recognize it for yourself. I mean, I can stand up here until I'm blue in the face and tell you about how great this movement can be if you do something. But it starts right in your own backyard. It starts right where you go every day. It starts right there in that sphere that you see every day. That's where it starts. But if your heart's not right, and you're not constantly allowing God to come in and clean that stuff out, then it's just like the blind leading the blind. Where are you leading people to? Do you even know the direction to God's kingdom? Do you know the direction? That's what Jesus was saying to these guys. You don't even know the direction of where my kingdom's at. You guys are worried about all this little stuff. You're worried about all the drama. You're worried about all the traditional stuff. You're worried about why the lights are dark. You're worried about why the music's loud. You're worried about why the pastor doesn't wear a suit every time he preaches. And all the while, the world's waiting for this movement to start. The world's waiting for us. The world's waiting for you. And the longer you sit there and think you have nothing to offer, the longer you sit there and think, well, I'm not a leader, I don't really have any influence, the longer we delay the movement God's called us to. And it's not my job. Well, I take that back. It is my job, but like I just said, I can stand up here with a microphone all day, but once the microphone comes off, there's work to be done. This is just like a pep rally right here. There's a game to be played on the field, and you need to get in it. There's too many people in churches across the world that are just warming the seats, and they think coming to church is about warming the seats and applauding the pastor when he says something good. Yeah, that's good, pastor. Man, I'm going to write that down. I'm not going to do anything with it, but I'm going to write it down. And the longer you sit on the bench and think you're here just to warm the seats, the longer we delay the movement God's called us to. Do you understand what I'm saying? There is a world out there, this giant world. The world is bigger than your street that you live on. The world is bigger than Watson Boulevard and Russell Parkway. Okay, it's a lot bigger. Has more red lights too. We have to get outside of this mentality that we think we have to conform to. Because we live in the South, everything moves slower. Oh, we'll get to it when we get to it. We'll do it when we do it. Yeah, we're supposed to be planning churches, but it's just so much work. Yeah, I own a business. I know how to successfully run an organization. I know how to get people to show up and serve passionately. I know how to do that, but I got my own stuff I'm running over here. The church can't use me. The church needs you. The church needs you to offer your gift to make it better. That's why you don't see as many strong, passionate churches creating movements, because the people in them think they have to leave to go be great. We'll get to that in May. I'm jumping ahead. I think I'm jumping ahead, right? We talked about it in our creative meeting the other day. We have us all, I'm jumping ahead. I'm getting too excited. Too excited. Just come back in May. Come back in May. So how are you carrying out the vision? How are you carrying out to lead people to Jesus no matter the cost? How will you be a part of the movement? How will you be a part of that? Because those dealings with people that you have, they're creating perceptions in their mind of you. They're creating perceptions of you. And they're either negative or they're positive. And if they're negative, obviously you're hurting your own influence to lead someone to Jesus. Right? Because the more consistent of the negativity they see from you, the more they perceive that you're just a negative person and they don't want to be around you. How are you going to lead someone to Jesus if they don't even want to be around you at all? Right? I want you to remember this statement. You cannot influence people with whom you do not associate with. You cannot influence people with whom you do not associate with, especially if they do not want to associate with you. Right? We need to make our relationship with Jesus attractive. Our relationship with Christ should be attractive. It should put off this vibe that it is fun and it is exciting, and serving Jesus is actually a thrill. All right? It's not boring. Our lives need to be attractive to other people, because Jesus is going to send people your way so you can lead them to Him. He's going to. If you pray for the opportunity, He's going to do that. But what are you doing with that opportunity? Are they seeing like a dull, just kind of living, this is it, this is all there is to it? Nobody wants to be a part of that. And it starts in your heart. It starts with your attitude. It starts with yourself. And you can blame other people. You can blame your parents for raising you that way. You can blame all that. But when it boils down to it, it's your heart and your heart alone. And the only one I can change it is God. But if we don't ask Him to constantly clear our hearts, create in me a clean heart, O God. Renew a steadfast spirit within me. I pray that every day. Create in me a pure heart, O God, and renew a steadfast spirit in me. I ask Him that. You know what? He does it. I walk in unforgiveness. I don't have any bitterness. Because I give that all to Him. What am I trying to do, carry it around? There's too many people, too many lives at stake for me to be dealing with that. There's too many people who need to be led to Jesus for me to be dealing with that. There's too many people that are hurting and needing someone to step up and say, you know what? I live for Jesus and it's fun and I love it and I want you to experience the same thing. It's time for us to be bold. Movements don't happen with timid people. Movements don't happen when we were just satisfied with sitting here. Movements don't happen that way. Do you know, I heard someone, I may get this a little wrong, but just go with me. There were the youth in China, it was back in the day, they took this book that, and I'm gonna just mess this up, so just go with me. But they took this book. It was the Sayings of Mao, I believe it was called. If I'm getting it wrong, whatever. But it's the Sayings of Mao. And it was the whole communist manuscript of the beliefs of why you should be a communist, all that whole stuff, right? These youth committed to knowing that book by heart. To know it by heart. And it literally changed the whole country, because some people got a hold of something that was bigger than themselves and said, I want to be a part of that, and if I'm not the head man, whatever, I don't care, I just want to be a part of it. And they took that, and they changed their part of the world. Now, we have a book called the Bible. What are we doing every day with it? Is it just something that you leave on your coffee table and your living room opened up to Psalms 23? People come over. Hey, yeah, I read my Bible. It's open right now. You see that? Yeah. Got two candles on the side burning. Is it a decoration? You know, you go get your Bible. Let me see. Man, let me read this thing. You know, is it that? We got to be hungry for it. And I can diesel on and I can just hit you with why it's so important we should be a part of this movement. But we got to personally be hungry for it. We can't just sit on the sidelines, watching the world take control of other people's lives, watch the world hypnotize people into thinking that their way is the best way. We have something to offer. We have freedom. We have joy. We have salvation. We have an eternity to spend in heaven. What can we do to bring excitement to that, to make that attractive to people? It's already attractive in itself. We have to be bold. We got to do things that push us to our boundaries, that push us to our limits as a person. We got to commit God's word to heart. And you're not going to be perfect. Nobody's perfect when it comes to that. I mean, just commit it to your heart. Just learn day by day something that you can put into your heart and apply it to your life. That's where it starts. Because if you don't put something in there, the enemy will. And we got to constantly fight that. So how are you going to influence people if you don't associate with them, especially if they don't want to be around you? So how can we get people to be attracted to how we live for Jesus? How can we do that? I don't have an answer. I'm just telling you. How? What does that look like for you? That's how you answer it. What does that look like for you? And it may be the simplest of things. I mean, movements are created by many moving small parts working together. But you got to realize where you're at is where God's put you, and he has you there for a reason. And if you don't come to the understanding that you are where you are because God has you there, you'll never be as influential as you possibly could be because you're still complaining about where you're at. But God has you where you're at for a reason. Realize that. And walk in every day knowing I'm here for a reason. God, what are you doing? Okay, can I come join you? God, what are you doing today? Can I join you? He'll let you every time. But it boils down to the heart. And we got to understand that is leadership in itself. That is influence. But if you're walking around blind, we can't change the world. We can't start a movement. We can't get this movement rolling. But it starts with every person in this room right here. You got to take hold of it. You got to take hold of it. And that means when we come in, we don't sleep when we come to church. It's not nap time. It's not time to catch a quick nap. I've seen people flat out. Sad to say, while I was preaching, I guess I was pretty boring. I don't know. Just being honest, man, like, when we come in this building, this is a building. You are the church. This is a building. When we come in here to gather together, how excited we should be to live in a country where we're free to worship and to sing to our Savior. I mean, it should be a thrill. It shouldn't be something where you go, ah, crap, it's church tonight. Like, what is that? People would kill to be in your spot. People would trade lives with you in a minute just to be in an air-conditioned room hearing the gospel. And we got to affect every part of our culture, every sphere of influence. There's a church in the Ukraine is pastored by an African man. His first name is Sunday. I can't pronounce his last name. But his first name is Sunday. He pastors over 100,000 people. 100,000 people. And they have, I think he said the number was about 100 government officials that go to his church. And they have grabbed a hold of this movement, this vision that this church has to affect every part of culture. And they are getting fed the word of God, and these government officials are going back, and they're the leaders of the country. He has supermodels that go to that church. They're supermodels. They model, but yet, because they know Christ, they're teaching young girls about abstinence, and it's not good to have sex before marriage, and why you should keep yourself pure. You can still be beautiful and still wait. They're affecting culture. They're affecting businesses. They're affecting the sports arenas. They have athletes that go to those churches. And every area, they have people that are doing something for the specific reason to bring glory to God. They're doing something for the specific reason for the movement of the church. That's their sole purpose for being in those positions. They're not doing it for their own gain. They're not doing it for their own self. They're doing it because they see something bigger than themselves, And they want to be a part of it, whether it's a small piece or a big piece. And once we grasp that here in America, because we're a selfish people in America, we're stingy, we're greedy, and if it doesn't help us, we don't want to do it. And if we don't get anything out of it, we don't want to do it. And you got to pay everybody to do everything. People look at the church as like it's a prostitute ring. You got to pay people to do stuff. Whatever happened to just being a servant? Whatever happened to the words of Jesus? You want to be the greatest? Serve. You don't have to be out front on a stage. Go in the parking lot and wave people in. How about that? Lower your pride a little bit. You don't have to be up front and the lights and all that stuff. You don't have to. You don't have to be the kind of person that gets a pat on the back every time you do something, because you're just doing it. You're not doing it for man. You're doing it for God. And if you're always waiting on someone to applaud you, you're doing it for the wrong reason. And the kind of people that we need to start to be here at New Hope International, if we're going to change this world and start a movement and keep this movement going, are people that are just servants. We just want to serve. It doesn't matter what you say. It doesn't matter if you get applauded. It doesn't matter who tells you thank you. It doesn't matter. I'm just going to serve because that's what Jesus told me to do. And it doesn't matter who sees me. It doesn't matter if I get an award. I just want to serve because that's what my Savior instructed me to do. And when we get that, when we get that kind of idea, and we get that deep in our hearts, the movement starts to move forward. The movement no longer stays a monument. It starts to uproot and starts to roll. It starts to gain steam, starts to gain momentum. And before you know it, we have government officials that are leading our city. We have athletes that are in the NBA and the NFL that are leading people to Jesus no matter the cost. And we have people who own businesses who are running their business for the sole purpose to support the church. I'm talking about major stuff, big time stuff that will change the world. And it starts with you and me in our heart. And we have to constantly, day by day, beat our flesh into submission. Do you want to be a part of a movement? Do you want to be a part of a movement? Okay, well, I'm telling you, God's going to do some great things to this church. He's already doing great things. But what's on the horizon, what's ahead of us, is going to be something that is going to blow our minds. And I would challenge you, stay on board. Stay in the game. Don't become weary in doing well. Stay in the game and let God use you in mighty ways, because you are a part of a movement. And continue to serve, continue to lead, continue to influence people right where you're at every single day. Don't waste an opportunity. Look for it. Pray for the opportunities.